The scripture reading this morning is from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 9 to 10. I will read from different Bibles. If you'd like me to read your Bible, bring it up here. И да будут слова сии, которые я заповедую тебя сегодня в сердце твоем, и внушай их детям твоим, и говори о них, сидя в доме твоем, идя дорогою, ложась, вставая, и навяжи их в знак на руку твою, и да будут они повязкой над глазами твоими, и напиши их на косяках дома твоего и на воротах твоих. Now I'll read in a foreign language. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk of them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands, and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames, on your houses, and on your gates. Amen.
This is a great passage here in Deuteronomy chapter 6. It is so great that the traditional Jew would put this passage on a phylactery, and they would tie it around their head, upon their forehead, and around their arm as well. Unfortunately, as Jesus Christ said in Matthew chapter 23, where he's talking about the phylactery, is that many times that passage never got from the head to the heart. But nevertheless, this is a great passage. And there are three great things that I want us to look at in this passage. The first is the great confession. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. Now, what does that mean? I think it means a couple of things. Number one is that the God of Israel is the unique God. He is the only God. And he demonstrated this when he delivered Israel out of Egypt. You probably already know this, that every one of the plagues was directed at one of the gods of the Egyptians. And so that every one of the plagues was a sort of a nail in the coffin of their polytheism, that your gods are not the true God, but the God of Israel is the one true God. But the God of Israel is also the God of the nations. Not just the God of Israel, he's the God of the nations. In fact, if you read the Psalms, you don't have to read very many of them where the psalmist is imploring the nations to praise this God, not only because he has redeemed Israel out of Egypt, but because he is the creator of all mankind. And so this God of Israel, the Lord Jehovah, is the one God. And he is one God. We do not worship many gods. He is one God, and yet he has revealed himself in three persons. Now, it's a little bit difficult to understand how much the typical Jew would have understood about the Trinity of God, that is, one God in three persons, though it was talked about in the Old Testament. There are a couple of passages that are crystal clear that there had to be more than one person in the Godhead. One of those, for instance, would be in Isaiah, where it is talking about the birth of the coming Messiah, and his name will be called God, Jehovah, and yet he is separate from God the Father. And Zechariah also, we find where the angel of the Lord has the power and authority to forgive sins, and only God has that authority, as is made clear in the New Testament when four guys brought their friend before Jesus to be healed, and Jesus said, "Your sins are forgiven." And the Pharisees, "Only God can forgive sins." And Jesus says, That's right. And to demonstrate that I have the power to forgive sins, he says, get up and walk, and he did. Also in the Old Testament, we see the Spirit of God. We see it hovering over the earth at creation. We see the Spirit of God empowering individuals like, for instance, King David to be able to do mighty things. And so even though this verse says that our God is one God, it doesn't argue against the fact that our one God is one God in three persons. And of course, this is made crystal clear in the New Testament, that our God is one God and yet three persons. It is hard for us to get our minds around this concept because there is really nothing on this earth that is quite like that. Though the marriage relationship is similar to it, in that the Bible says that when a man and woman come together, they are now one, and yet they are two persons. The man and woman are, in essence, they are the same. Man and woman are made in the image of God. They are rational people. They are moral people. Obviously, there are physical differences between a man and woman, but in essence, the man and the woman are one, and yet they are two distinct persons, which means that they communicate with one another, so that when, for instance, Jesus Christ is praying to the Father, he isn't talking to himself. He is talking to the first person of the Godhead, the Father. Just as when I'm talking to my wife, I'm not talking to myself, I'm talking to my wife. When she's talking to me, she is talking to herself. You don't listen to what I have to say. I'm trying, 37 years, I'm trying to listen. But you get the idea. And so this is the great confession that we find in this text, is our God is one God. He is the God. There aren't multiple gods. And by the way, it argues for the fact, as Jesus said, there is only one mediator between God and man, and that person is Jesus Christ. And he is the only way to salvation. There is no other name under heaven whereby people are saved. Thank you, brother. The second great thing that we notice in this passage is the great responsibility that is laid now upon the nation of Israel and us by extension. And that is, we are to love the Lord our God with all of our mind, all of our heart, and all of our strength. What it simply is saying here is that we are to love God with all of our being. That lip service, we just sang songs of praise unto God, which is a good thing to do. We are commanded to do that. But if we think that that's all that loving God is, we are mistaken. Jesus said to some of the religious leaders of the day, he said, you honor me with your lips, but your heart is far from me. In other words, your treasure isn't God, it's something else. Also, when it says that we are to love the Lord our God with all of our mind, heart, soul, and strength, it is more than ceremonial duty. In the Old Testament, the Jew had to give sacrifices. It was commanded. It was part of the religious service. But it was supposed to be an expression of one's heart towards God. Instead, many of the Jewish people were offering up sacrifices, thinking that that is a demonstration that I love God. And God's reply to the prophets is this: I'm sick of your sacrifices, because you do this religious duty, but once again, your heart is somewhere else. You are not treasuring God. And sometimes people attempt to love God, hoping that if they do all of these things, that somehow God will ultimately love them. But that is not how we're to love God either. It's interesting that in this text in Deuteronomy chapter 6, it comes after God's amazing love displayed to the nation of Israel. God freely redeemed them from their oppressive enemies, the Egyptians. and gave them redemption, and then promised them that they are now going to go to a land flowing with milk and honey. This was all graciously given to the nation of Israel. Now, in light of this amazing love, we are to love God. You know, John says these exact words in 1 John. We love him because he first loved us. It's not the other way around. We're not trying to earn brownie points. The amazing thing is that God has displayed his amazing love to the nation of Israel at the Exodus. He has shown his amazing love to mankind at the cross. And for those who have accepted the cross, we are now loving him because he has first loved us. And so this is very much like when a person falls in love. That you now have only eyes for the one that you've fallen in love with. You know, when Carol and I were dating, it was sort of a form of dating. We never really went out on date. I never really spent money on my wife. She reminds me of that periodically. When we were seeing one another, maybe that's the way I should say it. I said to her at one time, I don't think that I ever could love you for more than just a friend. And later on, you know, I sort of repented in sackcloth and ashes after saying that. And she responded with such a godliness. You know, I thought to myself, you know, I think I can love you for more than just a friend. And to make a long story short, where it seemed like this was not going to be planned out, I thought that she probably didn't like me after I said those rude words. And we met at church, and I even remember the things that she was wearing. And it was a green blouse that sort of accentuated her red hair. And it was like, wow, she's the love of my life. I was thinking only about her. She was the treasure outside of Christ, of course. But you sort of get the idea. And that is what God is saying here. Is the great responsibility is that we love the Lord our God with all of our mind, heart, soul, and strength. It isn't so much a duty as it is a delight. But those of us who are believers, we're well aware of the fact that this is a struggle as well, that we struggle with our loving God. And so, in the passage, it says that we are to place the Word of God on our hearts continuously so that our love might deepen and grow as we move along in our Christian life. So we need the Word of God desperately if we are to carry out this responsibility of loving the Lord our God with all of our mind, heart, soul, and strength. So how do we do that? Well, it's pretty simple. We need to have a regular reading of the Bible on our own. Every Christian should be doing that. We all fail, including the pastor, but that's our heart's desire, is that we want to read the Word of God. We should memorize the Word of God. Psalm 119, the psalmist says, I've treasured thy word in my heart that I may not sin against thee. We are to meditate upon the Word of God. Joshua 1:8. It always makes me think of a cow, being an old dairy man. A cow goes out and eats grass, and then it sets under the shade, and then it regurgitates what it has eaten. It's chewing its cud. And that's the idea there of Joshua 1:8, is that we intake the Word of God, and then as we are going along in our day, we regurgitate it through our minds. We're chewing on it. So we know how to respond in a given situation, because we can't always open our Bible, obviously, and read it as we are going. But you know, God has another way of helping us to get the Word of God implanted deep into our hearts and minds. And the way that God does this, and actually Moses explains this in just two chapters from Deuteronomy chapter 6 and Deuteronomy chapter 8, he says this: God let you go without food and water in the wilderness. Why did God do that? Because God doesn't love you? Because God doesn't care about you? You know, that's what a person is tempted to think. And you see, God does that with his people today. With every one of his believers, he takes things away from us. And our natural reaction is to think that God doesn't care about us, that he doesn't love us. And if we let that fester, we become bitter. And we begin to think of ourselves as victims. You know, why is God doing this to me? By the way, you can mark this as an absolute truth. If you think of yourself as a victim, you will never have peace and joy. Never. But that was not the intention of God taking away their basic necessities. Moses said, the reason that God has done this to you is so that you might open up the Word of God and discover that the Word of God is more important, more delightful than food and water and necessities. Proverbs, by the way, says those exact words. Hard to believe, and yet it's true. So you see, God takes things away. He weans us away from the world so that we might really feast upon his word and discover that it's sweeter than honey to our taste. That's why he does it. You know, Jesus Christ said the exact same thing when he was being tempted in the wilderness and he was close to starving after fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. And Satan comes to him and says, why don't you turn this stone into bread and feed yourself? And Jesus says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Brothers and sisters, if we have not learned this lesson, we're going to grow old as Christians and become grumpy and mean and joyless. We've got to learn this lesson. Is that when God takes things away from us, it is God's call to us to get into the Word of God and find our delight there. Delight thyself in the Lord. And so we have the great confession, Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. We have the great responsibility that we are to love the Lord our God with all of our minds, heart, soul, and strength. Then the third and last great thing that we are to do is the great transformation. Parents, we are to take this great confession, we are to take our love, and we are to transfer it to our children. You know, there is a thought out there in the world that says a parent should not influence their children. Are you aware of that? It's out there. People think that. How dare you as a parent influence your children? So the idea is that you give them a smorgasbord of theologies, ideologies, morals, and then your child can just pick for themselves which one that they want. Now, to be sure, at the end of the day, your child and my child will pick what they want. We can't force them to pick it. But on the other hand, I'm going to, as a parent, influence them. For instance, if they want to eat a rotten apple, I'm not going to say, well, whatever you want to do. If it's a rotten apple, I'm going to say, don't eat the rotten apple, eat the good apple. Why would I say that? Because I'm a bad parent? It's because I'm a loving parent. And by the way, a wise parent. I know the difference. Rotten, good. And so I'm going to tell them. And so when it comes to religious stuff, I'm not going to say, well, you know, you just pick and choose whatever you want to do. No. Don't pick bad theology. Don't pick bad ideology. Don't pick bad moralism. Pick the good things. What is the good things? Glad you asked. Deuteronomy 6, God is one God. Jesus Christ is Savior, and you need to love him. No, A parent is to influence their children. In fact, that is the command that we are to influence our children, regardless of what the intellects might say of our day. Now, we need to do it in a good way, a loving way. It says in the book of Proverbs that a wise person makes knowledge acceptable. And so, I wish that when our kids were little, that I was aware of the Discovery Bible Study that we as a church have been doing, where it's not a lecturing so much as you just read the Bible together and then ask some very pertinent questions. In other words, it's helping the child to read the Bible, and then you're asking questions pertinent to the Bible to help them to sort of discover it, and you're working alongside them, of course, in case they have bad ideas, that you can help them and so forth. But again, I wish that we had had this, because when our kids were little, we always struggled with devotional time. Though we did it, I just never really felt like it was all that great at times. I remember one time we were on vacation, and we were in the camper, and we're trying to have a devotional time on vacation, which is really an uphill climb, you know. And we're all sitting around, and I'm opening up the Bible, and I'm trying to give them like a 10-minute, you know, impactful message that the kids will just go away with this wonderful thought. And after I got through with this, I asked the kids, "So what do you think?" And the boys said something. I don't remember what they said, but I do remember what my daughter said. I said, "So Anna, what do you think about this?" And she goes, "Your little toe is bigger than my big toe." Really, that's what you got, you know. I'm glad, you know, that now actually she's going to church, and she has two little children, and I hope that she has a good devotional time with them as well. But anyway, and it, you know, it says here in this verse that as parents we are to constantly be teaching them, not in a lecturing, you know. We have to, like I said, a wise man makes it knowledgeable, makes knowledge acceptable. But you know, the reason why we have to do this is because our children are hearing an opposite message out there in the culture. Our culture is not helping us at all. Our culture is telling us bad ideas. Children are being influenced by their peers, and their peers usually do not have good ideas, good theology, ideology, or moralism. And so we as parents, we have to constantly fight against this, don't we? We have to constantly be teaching them. Don't assume, I've said this before, but don't assume because your child says, "I accepted Christ when I was 4 years old," that now your work is done. You have to constantly keep reinforcing the truth. Because not only is the environment against our children, but even their own minds. In fact, we as adults, we struggle with this, is that our minds are not gravitating towards the truth. Our minds are drifting away from it. And so we need to have this constant reinforcement of proclaiming the truth to our children. Are you feeling overwhelmed, parents, with young kids? But you know, God has given us something to help us along these lines, and that is the local church. The local church is a place that can help your children. And one of them is right now while I am preaching. Thank you, parents, by the way, having young children right up here in the front. Appreciate that. Not that it's bad to be back there. But you know, preaching the Word of God, obviously it is commanded by God. And the reason that we do it is because we believe that the Word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword. And believe it or not, that in spite of the pastor, that the preaching of God's Word can penetrate, can influence even young children. You know, in my former church, there was a mother that died, and she had three children, and she died just a couple of years ago. And her son said to her just before she died, you know, she wanted me to come back and do the funeral, and the reason why was because her son said is because I appreciate Terry's preaching so much. Now, the thing that was amazing to me is that I didn't think he was listening to one of my messages. Because as I would look out, he'd be sort of like over here, looking out over there, and it's like, is anything getting through to this guy? Lo and behold, it was. And the only thing I can say is because the Word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword. Even my own children. One time while I am preaching, there was a clock in the back just like that, and my oldest son goes, you know, you've been preaching too long. And then when he was in college, he left a message on my phone that I wish I had kept on there. He says, Dad, I just want you to know I listened to every one of your messages and appreciated it so much. Really? I didn't know that. I thought you wanted me to quit. And so it is good, parents, to bring your children to hear the Word of God being preached. It has an effect. And not only that, but in our culture today, started with, I think, Dwight L. Moody, we have Sunday school as well, where your children are being reinforced, hopefully, with what you're hearing at home, because ultimately it is the parents' responsibility, your children, but Sunday school is another great place that can be a help. Because for a couple of reasons. Number one is that I believe we have a great curriculum. We have a Desiring God curriculum for our young people. And the thing that is so awesome about this is that it is teaching morality in the framework of theology. If you try to teach morality without theology, what you end up with are Pharisees, religious hypocrites. And so Desiring God is, the focus is on God, and then what is our responsibility. And so that is what the curriculum is for our young people. I think it is outstanding curriculum. And then not only do we have an outstanding curriculum, we have outstanding teachers who love and care for your children. They are not there to babysit your children. They are there to help disciple your children. Parents, I'll just challenge you. If you've never done this, I would challenge you to go in to where your children are having Sunday school and just go in there and observe what is taking place between the teacher and the students. I've done it. I am awesomely impressed. It's like, I couldn't believe it. It's just these people are so committed to discipling your children. Even Lockwood, I was in his class. And that even came through with Lockwood and Mike Conley. Oh, Mike, you're guilty by association because of your association with Lockwood. Now, I can't go through and name everybody because I'll forget somebody. But I am very serious when I say this, is that the Sunday school whole process is a great place for parents to find help in this great transformation, where we as parents are to take this great confession and our great love for God and transfer it to the next generation. This isn't optional, by the way. This is a command. God expects us to do it. Now, let me just say this. Even with all of that, it doesn't mean at the end of the day your child is going to confess Christ and love Christ. It doesn't guarantee that at all. But we want to do all that we can. But at the end of the day, because your child will decide for themselves who they want to confess and who they want to love and who want to follow. But at the end of the day, your child should know that my mom and dad have confessed Jesus Christ. My mom and dad, they love Jesus Christ, but I have decided to reject it. I know what they want. I know what they love, but I'm not going to follow it. Right? You can't do anything. The old saying, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. But every child of a believer should know that the parent, what they believe and what they love and what they confess. But kids, listen to me. Trust and follow Jesus Christ, and you can never go wrong in doing that. Never. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this awesome text of greatness, of you, responsibility, and transformation. May we take it to heart, for it's in your name we pray. Amen.